by a stranger. And sometimes we hear that from within. But the circumstance in which this happens is usually the same. It's the type of phrase that comes out when there's a life crisis going on, a turning point in one's life, at a moment when one really needs to hear a few sobering words to shake up the soul. What's up with you, man? What's the deal, sister? Who you? What up, dude? In the name of God, what the heck are you doing to yourself right now? And sometimes the words are much stronger than the word heck, if you know what I mean. They are words that poke us back into attention, like smelling salts, when we need to come to our senses. Last spring, my wife and I were on vacation at Cape Cod, or trying to be on vacation, because my left eye was bothering me. It wasn't functioning right. I didn't seem to have my full eyesight. My peripheral vision was cut down rather dramatically. There seemed to be a strange blackness around the edges. And the scary thing was that it seemed to be getting worse, fast. Blackness was suddenly lowering down from the top, which is called a black curtain. That's when I heard words resonating all around me. What are you doing, Lob? What's your delay? Get this thing checked out fast! And a lot of people here know what happened next. We rushed home. I had an emergency appointment with the optometrist who determined I had a fast-growing, cancerous tumor in my eye. And a second opinion confirmed the same thing. Within a week, I was in a Philadelphia hospital, and my left eye was removed. Yes, this is a falsie. And if I hadn't listened to God, I may not be here today. Praise God for that. But that was my Elijah moment, when God said to me strongly, "What are you doing, Lob?" Maybe some people would say that what I heard wasn't the voice of God, but I would argue that it was, because you need a lot to get through this thick skull of mine. In our scripture today from 1 Kings, we see the blow-by-blow account of Elijah coming up close and personal with the Lord God Almighty. God was pleading with Elijah to evaluate his life. Things with Elijah had become unglued. His life had gotten out of control. The prophet was on some kind of crazy, zigzagging odyssey. He was a nomad, a fugitive, at the lowest point in his life. Earlier, he had brutally killed 450 false prophets of the ancient deity Baal, B-A-A-L, Baal. And even though it was justified, it was bloody. Because, let's face it, striking down 450 human beings is not the same as killing 450 mosquitoes. He felt remorse for that, second-guessing himself. He was confused and shamed and tormented. In addition, he was afraid because the evil, wicked Queen Jezebel had vowed to track him down and to get revenge. Elijah was suspicious of everything he saw. And because of that, he took a long, arduous detour through a harsh and unforgiving desert, lasting 40 days and 40 nights. And he wound up living in a cave on Mount Horeb. Not a house or a tent, but a damp, dank cave. The Bible's unclear about how he exactly got there, but maybe that's the point. Elijah himself probably didn't know how he got there. All he knows is that he feels ravaged and he's at wit's end. He abandoned all his servants, all his challenge to someone like the great composer Ludwig von Beethoven, who began to lose his eyesight at age 26. Imagine how difficult, not only to write a symphony, to dream up every note and orchestrate every musical part and to form one grand masterpiece, but then to do it while being deaf. Beethoven wrote and conducted in front of a live audience some of his most famous works, including the Ninth Symphony, while deaf. And I'm sure he, like Elijah, thought at some point, how did I ever wind up being here like this? What could I have done differently? What kind of fool am I? What has become of my life? And that's the moment in the Bible when God asks in verse 9, "For heaven's sake, Elijah, what are you doing with your life? Running away like this, living in a cave village with no self-esteem, no identity. What are you doing? Does this mean you're giving up the job that I gave you as one of my prophets?" And Elijah responds very respectfully in verse 10, "Not at all, Lord. I've been as zealous for you as ever." So God says, "Okay then, come out from your cave. Stand here at the side of the mountain where you will meet God." The commandment was so strong, Elijah had no other choice but to obey. And that's his key moment, which is important to pay attention to. Because when God speaks to us strongly, do we trust and obey? Or do we turn away in fear? God then offers up to the prophet three classic symbols that's used throughout the Old Testament to show the power of God's might: wind, earthquake, and fire. Scripture says the wind was so strong that it split the mountains and broke the rocks in pieces. It was much more powerful than 10 hurricane Sandys. You think Elijah expected to hear God roaring in the wind, but Scripture says the Lord was not in the wind. Secondly, there was an earthquake. It shook the earth below Elijah's feet and opened up great crevices, much more than any earthquake has ever hit Japan or Haiti or the Philippines. But Scripture says again, the Lord was not in the earthquake. Then Elijah witnessed the fire that scorched the trees on the hillsides and burned up all the brush in the valley below, worse than any of the terrible wildfires in California by the Santa Ana winds. But Scripture says for a third time, the Lord was not in the fire. What a fascinating piece of revelation. We're told by the Bible, no less, that catastrophic occurrences, though they may be called acts of God, are not the way in which people should be listening to God. And when we think about it in modern terms, it makes sense, because catastrophic events are, for the most part, just science, right? A tsunami is translated by the ancients as a harbor wave. It's caused by a displacement of a large body of water, which creates a powerful vibration of water that can hit an entire coastal region. And an earthquake is caused by a sudden release of energy in the earth's crust, which creates seismic shifts in the plates of the ground. And we know the earth is full of these fault lines. And a wildfire feeds off combustible material found in woods and forests, which ignites so easily, like brush, dead wood, twigs, leaves, and oxygen. That's what gives it fuel. So natural disasters are just that, disasters. And who can prevent them from happening? Not you, nor me. But our scripture from 1 Kings teaches us an important lesson. It's that God does not speak inside of events like those. They might be prompted by geology or meteorology or even the winds of chance, but they're not prompted by God. However, sometimes in and around those kind of tragedies, including tragedies and suffering in our own lives, by the way, help spring on times when God does speak. And Scripture teaches us in verse 12 the best way to listen for God, which says, after the fire, there was the sound of sheer silence. Elijah heard it and stepped out from his cave with a scarf wrapped around his face. In effect, the Bible is telling us that in the silence of the moment, Elijah finally understood what God was trying to say to him. It was in the silence of the moment. And because of that, he surrendered before God. Elijah learned when to listen for God's voice. Because at that exact moment, in the silence, God's voice came. And it came as a whisper. And when all the catastrophic events are over, when the clamor and noise and chaos finally calms down, what is left is the silence of God's voice. That's the best time to listen for God. Let's practice meditating on that for a moment, okay? Let me hear a big, gigantic, semi-long silence. This, friends, is exactly the type of moment when God came upon his prophet Elijah and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah? What's going on with you? What is it that you're supposed to be doing with your life?" So it's no wonder that's when God comes to us and speaks to us. God comes to us in the quiet aftermath. Lots of times in a whisper, sometimes not, but lots of times that's when God announces himself. So in conclusion, I ask, what are some of the earthquakes going on right now in your life? And what kind of chaos is floating around your brain that needs to be taken care of by the silence of God's love? And what Scripture makes plain is that when you're ready to hear it, God's love will come through the softness and through the gentleness and in the serenity of the quiet moments. And that can help to overcome any affliction. And in a final twist in our Scripture, God ends up by saying to Elijah, "Go back the way you came. Go back through the desert to Damascus and do your work." God is telling Elijah, as God tells us, face what you need to face. Don't run away. Face it like a man, or face it like a woman. And it can be done. We can travel through the narrow gate that Christ describes for us. We can go back from where we came from. Or we can go the other way, knowing that God